So I think I really could have avoided 100,000 words of garbage. If I could go back, I would have stopped writing it when I felt like it was going off. No clear desire line. Hi there, my name is Nicole. I am a writer and story nerd, and today I am going to talk about my novel that I drafted for Camp NaNoWriMo in April 2020 called 1837 that I recently reread about a week ago and why it is bad. In this video, I'm going to take you through where I think I went wrong and how I recognize the problems in it, what problems I have in it. And these are not problems that are just specific to my novel. And my hope is that by sharing the big mistakes that I made, the big problems with my own novel, you might be able to find some of these in yours or preemptively not make the same ones that I did. There is no doubt that this is bad. It is bad. But I don't feel discouraged about it or like I need to put it down. So the reason for that is I feel like this was a necessary step in getting the book to a good place. It needed to happen. Did it need to happen in 100,000 words? No. I don't think I needed to have the full draft to figure out what the problems were. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how I think I could have avoided the whole thing and figured this out earlier at the very end of this video. But let's get right into these problems. So the first problem in the novel that is very obvious, I'm calling exposition versus setup. So this happened because I was discovery writing. I basically would come up with an idea as I was discovery writing and say, "Oh, I want that to happen." So there would be a big chunk of exposition right before some result or decision or event. So for example, take this bit of exposition where my character's plans to join the rebellion are foiled. The one problem with sneaking away in the middle of the night, rather than officially leaving the house in a wagon, was that Greer and Drew's plan relied on the use of two horses and even the stable hand. They'd envisioned routes around the city, how they could pass back and forth between the rebels without causing suspicion, and how they could use the stable hand as a guard while performing official business. Now, of course, they had none of that. The problem. I came up with this plan when I wrote this paragraph. So all of the events that foiled the plan have already happened when this is showing up. That is bad because the plan's been foiled, but I'm just explaining it now. So the audience didn't know that there was a plan, so they didn't know that there were any stakes during the actual earlier action. And it's also confusing and boring. Why is this here? It's because I had a new idea for a scene and I was like, they need to have a plan so that I can do this other scene so they can get back to the plan. And so I just put the plan in after the plan was messed up. It doesn't even make sense. It's not good writing, right? And another example from the same page. Holland Landing is at least an hour or two ride away, Drew said, and Mackenzie could be anywhere. We need horses, there's no question. She should have taken a course with her when she ran away. Why hadn't she been thinking clearly? It's because the author hadn't been thinking clearly. Does your father have any? Drew sighed. Yes, there's a veritable horse show at the brewery. This seems a little convenient. I threw it in because I suddenly wanted them to like sneak in and steal a bunch of horses, but that wasn't set up earlier. That's so convenient. If I was a reader reading that, I'd be like, excuse me, why didn't we hear about this veritable horse show at the brewery earlier? Like, this can happen with characters, with scenes, with beats, or revelations. The treatment for it is really to recognize that not all of these random developments that I came up with while I was discovery writing are good, but some of them are. So you choose which ones you want to use, and then you set them up earlier. Setup can sometimes require a few lines in the beginning, or perhaps a brief beat or a conversation, or maybe you need a whole other scene. So where the plan, the first example, I really should have put in a scene where the characters work out their plan to escape to join the rebellion a few chapters earlier. And then when everything falls apart, while I'm describing the action of things falling apart, the audience knows that things are falling apart. So it actually has like meaning. And I could have mentioned the brewery having a lot of horses. It's for delivery, by the way, because they have to like bring kegs around in wagons, I guess. And I could have mentioned that in passing or in an earlier chapter, or how did like a scene actually take place at the brewery. It doesn't have to have anything to do with it, but just be like, oh wow, there's a lot of horses here. And that would have solved the problem. So the second problem is that there is no clear desire line. This is the big one, and it's related to everything else. It's not like I wrote it with my characters not wanting something. I wrote down what they wanted at one point. The problem was, I feel like it wasn't specific enough. The cause of this really was the fact that I am writing a historical fiction book that's like very centered on actual events in history. So I had to follow the historical timeline of events for this revolution. But the problem is, by just following the timeline and having the characters like show up at the different things I thought they could conceivably show up at, it feels episodic and unconnected. It feels like there's not a good middle. So if you hear things about like, it feels episodic, it doesn't feel like there's a long enough middle, or there's a lack of forward momentum, or even confusion to how certain elements fit together, this also might be a problem in your story. So how do I fix this? It's the desire line really needs to be something tangible, and we have to know the moment when the character has achieved it or not. Something vague like they want independence is great, but in most cases this isn't enough. Wants to open a school for young girls is a more solid desire line because we know when and if they achieve it. Win the competition, find food to feed the village, win the game, like all of those things. We know when they achieve it, it's solid enough that you can build a story around it and you can really work towards it better. The third big problem is having the wrong hero for the story. So yeah, my book is really a complete mess. I was trying to put two young girls into the middle of the 1837 rebellion in Upper Canada. And there is no way that I can get them into the heart of the rebellion. This story started as something else. In third year, in 2017, I was hiking through a forest in Wales, and I came up with a story idea that involved three characters that are in this book, but that was a fantasy story. It was completely different. It was action-adventure, and eventually, through a whole bunch of convoluted pathways, I got it to 1837 because I decided I wanted to write about Canadian history. The problem is, I've been trying to kind of put two stories together. I have this like action-adventure story, and then I have this rich girls in Upper Canada story that are trying to be mushed together. But the truth of the matter is, I know my characters really well, and I cannot make my characters want to overthrow the government in Upper Canada. Like, I can't make them want to be part of the rebellion because they're the rich people. They're the ones, they're like working to overthrow themselves, or at least working to overthrow their family. One of them seriously does not belong in the rebellion. Like, she's not interested. She doesn't fit at all. And the other one's a little bit more rebellious and a little bit more of like a tomboy and stuff sort of thing, but she wouldn't want to either. She loves her family a lot, despite the fact that she disagrees with certain things that they do, but she still loves them. And I can't make them want the things that they would have to want to do the story that I've written. And so I kept having really, really complicated justifications for why the characters wanted what they wanted, and I had trouble giving the characters to do things in certain moments. I had too many storylines, and I felt like I really wasn't getting into emotional depth in the scenes because things would keep coming up as I was writing that were problematic. So here's one thing. I'll just give an example. So the girls decide to join and help the rebellion, and their justification is, oh, like, this is just supposed to be an armed demonstration. We're just gonna go protest. We're gonna help them do this great protest, and it's gonna help things. It's definitely not gonna turn into a rebellion with violence, no way, which is ridiculous because, first of all, they've been involved in smuggling weapons through the town, and it takes away the entire tension if my characters are like, yeah, there's not gonna be any problems. It's gonna be totally peaceful. But they've been smuggling weapons. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense for the characters. The reader doesn't believe it. It's just a mess. But I had to, that is justification historically that the leaders were using to get people to come to this peaceful demonstration or armed demonstration. They were just trying to overwhelm. They weren't trying to like have a big battle. But it doesn't work in the context of my story. It doesn't work. And there's a really great parallel here with The Crimes of Grindelwald, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, The Crimes of Grindelwald, where all the bunch of critics, and I used to love watching videos about this movie, is that Newt is not the character to be the main hero against Grindelwald. He just wants to play with his little animals. He's not there to like save the world from Grindelwald. And I feel like I had a similar problem in my story where not only was I sort of almost mixing two different genres and trying to make them clash, but also I was trying to put my characters in a setting that was not going to work. So what is the treatment for this? I think it's to choose one storyline and stick with it. So for Crimes of Grindelwald, everyone suggested it could have been much better if they just made it episodic, bring Newt to a new locale to rescue a beast, and don't involve Grindelwald. And so my girls are part of this rich society and they can reject the ideas of it, but I have to think in the historical context of the time. And the girls can't be leaders of this rebellion. They can't even really participate in the armed parts of it. Like, they can't be in the middle of it. I either need to sort of throw away some of the historical accuracy, maybe some of the historical events, and make a revolution story that's focused on action and sort of change where my girls come from, or I need to focus on the girls' stories in society. And it can still have suspense, it can still be intriguing, the rebellion can still be the background, but it just, they can't be there helping the whole time and fighting. It's just not going to work. Here's the big fourth problem. I knew as I was writing it, this is why I'm not discouraged. I knew as I was writing it that this was not going well. I knew things weren't clicking, things didn't feel right. There were first certain scenes that I just felt like I was like plugging through to get through them. And I shouldn't have done that. I really wanted to finish it. I finished novels before, but I was so worried because it had been a while, it had been a few years, that if I stopped writing it, I would not write the novel, if that makes sense. I would never finish it, and I didn't want to never finish it. So instead, I kind of did the opposite of force it to happen. Force it, whatever it takes, just get it down on paper. And that is what a lot of writing advice is, but I don't think it was the advice that I needed at that moment. If I could go back, I would have stopped writing it when I felt like it was going off, when I felt like intuitively things didn't feel good, and gone back to the drawing board and rethought what was going on. I think it's so important to remember that as writers, we've read so many stories, we've digested so many stories that we know intuitively when a story isn't working. It's just about listening to that intuition. And listen, the intuition is there. We just have to listen to it. And that's what I wasn't doing when I was writing the story. I was so desperate to get through it, to finish it, that I stopped enjoying it and I stopped believing in it. And I was so, and I ended up just going off the rails with the story, rather than saying, let's take a step back, let's figure out what's going wrong, and then let's start writing. So I think I really could have avoided 100,000 words of garbage if I had taken the time to say, hey, this isn't going well, why don't I stop? Why don't I stop and figure out how to make it go right? I am still incredibly excited to rewrite this story. I'm actually incredibly excited to rewrite this story. I'm really jazzed about it. I'm not discouraged at all. I have ideas for where it's gonna go. I'm excited about where it's gonna go. I'm still working kind of on redrafting and figuring out how things work. I feel like I've learned a lot since I started writing it almost 11 months ago now, and I'm super excited. So I want to say, if you reread a draft of your story and you're feeling the way I'm feeling, you can fix it. Don't get overwhelmed. Sharpen the saw, think through the problems, spend some time brainstorming, and the rewriting can help. So let me know, what big mistakes have you made in your own novels? Have you made any of these or other ones? How do you write, or what do you do when you feel the intuition that the story is not working? How do you react to that? How do you change? Do you change what you're doing? Do you keep going? And please, if you're still watching this, give this video a big thumbs up. YouTube loves thumbs up. Comment below. I would love to hear your comments. And if you're not subscribed to my channel, definitely do that. So thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next time. I'm sorry, what is up with, why is one of my eyes really dark and the other is not? Like, very obvious.